What up, YouTube? It's your boy Banks, and we back in the building. You feel me? It's True Talks, cause True Talks. All right, let's get straight right into it. So you already know, man. Obviously, last night was, you know, the end of the NBA season, the 2022 NBA season, 21-22. You know, they're champions. Give credit where credit is due to the Golden State Warriors. Obviously, I know a lot of y'all would try and come for me because I predicted it wrong. I predicted the Celtics in six, and instead it was the Warriors in six. And, you know, plethora of reasons why that happened, but we'll get into that later. But for the most part, you got to tip your hat off, for, you know, give credit where credit is due to Stephen Curry, yo. One of the most elite finals performances we have seen in just this NBA, you know, 75 years that this NBA has existed, to average 31.2 points, 6 rebounds and 5 assists, 2 steals, especially as a non-defender, you know what I'm saying, shooting on 48% from the field, 44% from 3, 86% from the free throw, like that's basically almost 50-40-90. Like, that's disgusting. You better trust him. Everybody else struggled. Andrew Wiggins shot 45% from the field, but struggled from 3. Like, he had a great series for the most part. Draymond Green was the unsung hero in this last game. I'm obviously going to show you why. But for the most part, you congratulate Steph Curry. Again, people have it twisted where they think that I was saying he's not elite. I never said he's not elite. I just said that there's levels to how you're elite. There's levels to the eliteness, right? Like, again, people bring up the KD and all that type of stuff. And for the most part, me, what I do, if you haven't been paying attention, it's about authenticity first. And understanding the game first with the trained eye, and then everything else second. There's not really any biases, right? It's people think that there's biases because they just don't understand what I'm saying. So they think that I'm being biased because I don't agree with X, Y, and Z. But for the most part, it's just about watching the footage. When you watch the footage, I understand basketball and I love basketball with a passion that it's about being authentic. That when I see the footage, it tells me who to rate, who to like, and et cetera. It's not a bias or anything like that. So when I watch the footage and I see Steph Curry, from especially from past finals, how they guard him, you switch everything, force him to one-on-one, he'll score in transition. It's hard to stop him in transition. There's going to be, you know, you get a turnover, boom. You like, it's hard. There's going to be a 1-2 miscommunication. Obviously, like, he moves around so much, and that's one of his assets, right? One of his skill sets is relocating and moving without the ball nonstop, that the gravity pull that he attracts opens up everything else for everybody else. Even Klay does the same thing as well, too. Both of them mainly, and then everybody else, right? You add pull to the mix now, it's dangerous. We already know that. But when you're attentive and you lock in defensively, especially being the best team in the East, being that you're supposed to have great elite Celtics defense, you force them to one-on-one, switch everything, all of that. Doesn't matter who he's one-on-one and against. You force him to one-on-one and you help off certain people. Like, you have Draymond in the game. You have Looney in the game. Help off certain people. You know, Draymond obviously was hit in this game, but that's the game plan I expected to be implemented. And based off that, I could foresee why the Celtics could win in 6 or 7, right? And that's kind of where my breakdown was lying. Didn't mean Steph Curry's not elite, but when he gets cut off from his eliteness, he struggles. And that's why you see the non-finals MVP, all of these other narratives that have been built around him. Why are they happening? And the footage tells you why they are happening, why KD was able to get 2, et cetera. Even Iguodala was able to steal one, which I didn't even agree with, but he stole one, right? So I think this should be Steph's second finals MVP, but it's his first. But that was where my IQ and where just, you know, my breakdown in terms of discussing Steph, et cetera, because a lot of people are saying, oh, he's one-on-one. He leads the ISOs one-on-one, all this type of stuff they're going with. And I'm saying it's cap because, again, the trained eye shows you. It's a lot of it's off screen. And even though it looks as one-on-one on paper, it's not really one-on-one because the screen just happened and now he killed you, even though you finally got there. It's actions, right? It's not like people run screens, like I said, but when you cut it off, he struggles more so in the one-on-one. Now, again, this game, he did a lot of one-on-one, especially on the back end of the fourth quarter. But you can't now do one-on-one when he's hot in rhythm. He smells a ring, comfortable lead. Like, he's going to kill you in those scenarios. You're not supposed to implement that late after you've been playing the drop, giving him open shots, all that type of stuff. So that's why, like, for me, Steph Curry is elite, and I know he's elite when he's in his actions. He's elite, period. The greatest shooter of all time. So when you don't give that guy what he wants, you know what I'm saying? Like, if you give him what he wants, he's the greatest shooter of all time, he will kill you.
But in the other finals, he didn't get what he wanted. He got a lot of ISO. He didn't get the ball movement as much. So that's why he had some struggles, especially before KD got there, et cetera, whatever the case is. But for the most part, and even when you look at the numbers, when KD was there, his finals, he had a great finals and stuff like that. But he did shoot not the greatest in those finals runs. Like, he wasn't the Steph that we know him to be. So when you look at that context, that's why I was saying Steph is elite, but there's still levels to it. He lacks the one-on-one, and that's why these finals, he has bad shooting performances. So, for the most part, I'm not expecting the Celtics to play a drop and play into his hands and do all these things. Now, they did change the drop, but you'll see. We'll go into the context, and you'll see kind of what transpired with, like, you just let go of him in transition. You just miscommunicate here, miscommunicate there. Just bad defense from the Celtics, giving him what he wants. And if you give him what he wants, he's going to be great. He's going to shoot it. Like, this is what he does. I didn't expect him to do that. And that's where I was wrong in that. And I guess me being foolish was expecting the Celtics to just be smart 100%, not turn over the ball as much. Like, they just played bad. And what the inexperienced team definitely showed. Like, the experience is not just playing there a lot. It's the intangibles, right? It's not necessarily experience, just the intangibles. Like, Draymond has all the intangibles in the world. Steph even has intangibles. Klay does. Like, they have so much intangibles. Andrew Wiggins has it as well, too, around the proper culture. I thought that the Warriors, that intangible wouldn't matter when they just switch everything. You're going to be forced to be in your unconventional route. And they didn't put them in that. And when they put them in that, it was already out of hand. So, like, it's just, that's kind of was my breakdown for everything, obviously. And, you know, I was wrong, clearly, and I'm going to stand on it. And I know that I'm wrong, you know, obviously. But I'm not going to take back what I said because I agree by what I say based off the footage. I'm going to stand on it. Like Draymond said, stand on your shit. And you know I stand on my shit. But at the end of the day, when I'm wrong, I'm wrong. You know what I mean? But even when I'm wrong, I'm still right, though. It's not a typo. Let's go into the context because I give it a context. Let's go straight right into it, boy. So as you can see in the first quarter, the Celtics obviously start out the game with a 12-2 run, and with Tatum with an ISO, I might go psycho. My goodness, boy. My God, Joe. But this is the problem. Tatum didn't abuse the midi often, and that's what happened where the chain reaction transition. And you can see Wiggs said, I'm going to give you the biz. And just everything just started to fall apart. And you can see great contest by Draymond. Rebound, you know, D-sound. Draymond played out of his mind. My goodness, look at this. Horford in the drop. Bucket. Boom, boom. That's Klay Day. He said it's a payday. What are we talking? See? And then right here, look at Draymond's defense. Right here, the same in the midi off the bump. Off Looney, he stunts. Gaps. So Tatum can't even have a shot. Then recovers to Jaylen Brown. Elite defense. And then guards him on the perimeter. Cuts off the two cutoff three. My God, three cutoffs, bruh. Draymond defensively is elite, played out of his mind. And look right here, the Celtics, look at Marcus Smart, same thing. Great cutoff, great help by Tatum. Got a turnover, got a steal, and then leads to transition. Derek said, I don't fear it, bruh. And that's what I'm trying to tell y'all. Like, the Celtics played good half-court defense, but what transition was the turnovers, great defense by Draymond. Look right here, you can see, even again, initially, Horford not in the drop. He's playing hedge hard. He's stunting aggressively. Then he's going to recover back to Looney. Great defense to cancel Steph action, right? And for the most part, again, they played great half-court defense to start, and Klay game six. My goodness. Dog. Here we go. He's trying to let Mans know that here we go. But, dog, the Celtics offense started to be more stagnant. Tatum not abusing the midi right here. Wiggins, great defense. Wiggins been padding Tatum all series, bro. Dog, is what Elite looks like. Wiggins is just with that Kawhi straps. That's what he's doing. That's what he's applying. Right here, they switch. You can see that they switch, obviously. Robert Williams is kind of in the drop, but it's extended. He can afford that because he has length on the contest, right? So he could play differently than Horford, but they played great defense to start out in the half court. But then again, you're going to start seeing offensive rebounds kill the Celtics and transition. Right here, another action again. Robert Williams plays high, gets back. Right here, great defense they're playing. But then right here, Robert Williams now has an ISO with Steph Curry. This is what I want if I'm the Celtics. But you got to play defense better. With Gary Payton and Looney on the court, you could force him to drive but still help. Look right here. Robert Williams should force him to the right, but no, he gets beat. going to his left on the crossover by Steph Curry, because Jaylen Brown's right there sitting on the left hand, but he gets beat to the opposite. And right there, you can see Smart should go contest, but he stays on Looney. Why? Hey! And he said, I'm going to go by the layup. I'm going to fly. Bruh, Curry, great ISO ability right there, even though I'm thinking they're going to play better defense. Right here in the midi, you have it. Got to go. And you can see that Tatum is pulling in the midi, but he stopped going to it. He went away from it, and that's where the game transitioned. And you can see right here, great defense by the Warriors. Right here, a baby. And right here, look at this, mano-a-mano with Curry. He's playing good contained defense, but look at Looney. He stunts. He basically over-aggressively doubles. Pivot, travel by Jaylen Brown, and look, a turnover. Two turnovers basically in one play. They didn't call a travel. That's great help by Looney. Do you see what I'm saying? The difference. The Warriors are on a string in the help, and the Celtics aren't. Right here again, you see how Williams stunts. He stunts properly, cuts it off, played great defense right here. Tatum even affords and helps on the drive, which he can because Draymond Green not a shooter. But I'm going to hit the ones that matter. Buckets on a platter. Draymond played out of his mind, yo. He was the unsung hero. 100%. Tatum right here. Go to work. You have a baby on you. See? Okay. In the midi. Right here. He's about to do a turn fade. Beautiful. He traveled a little bit. Right here. You pump fake. He jumps. Jump into him. Nope. Tatum passes. I don't know what that's about. Not being aggressive. And you live with Derek White shooting those if you're the Warriors. Transition killers. That's what they do. See? Handoff. Not there. Relocate. Read. Handoff. Bump screen. That's got to go. My goodness. And that's and one, two. Bruh. Steph. The Warriors in transition, they're just killers, yo. You can't, dog. This is how the game turned around. You could see the game just was never the same after that. Forcing him to ISO. Okay, look, why are you passing, Tatum? Why are you passing? Good block by Wiggins. Great, yo, Wiggins' defense. Great strip by GP. Dog. He said, you see me. Look at them. Look how they're moving. Transition killers. Look at this. Transition and offensive rebounds. My God. Boom. Pool said it's a party. Head to the pool. What are you talking about, yo? 11-0 run just like that. And look, see, great defense. Good defense. Tip out by Draymond. Elite, bruh. My goodness, yo. Draymond said I'ma stay long in the league because I do the little things. Look at the switchability. Look at great defense. Look at his rebound transition again. Everything was all transition. See Wiggins. Reverse me. Said I'm thirsty. Pop. Put him in a hearse, B. My goodness, kill him. That's what they're doing. All transition, yo. Even though I wanted the Celtics to win, look at this. Even though I wanted the Celtics to win, not wanted, but thought they were going to win. Look at his rebound. My goodness, Draymond said, I'm going to change that answer. I'm going to change the outcome. All the little things Draymond doing. I thought that, you know what I'm saying, with the elite IQ, with the breakdown, and with the personnel. Look at the cookies. Look at the help. Everything helped. Another transition, but... Another transition bucket. I thought that with the elite breakdown, you can see Steph is amped. Everything transition. Push. Transition offensive rebounds. I'm thinking that the Celtics would be themselves, and then we will have, you know what I mean, a 21-0 run on your floor? That's impossible. That's crazy, yo. That should never happen, yo. Tatum, do something. Wiggins padding. He's not even being aggressive on Tatum. And you can see Tatum's not even being aggressive on Wiggins. You can see JB is putting in work. He's trying. You know what I'm saying? But right here, again, you can see in the drop, recover, bruh, rebound. Again, offensive rebound, transition. No, sorry, offensive rebound leading to something. And right here on the screen, obviously, Horford plays properly, perfect. Step back, and then he jumped, bruh. Why? My goodness, because his Curry can get buckets in a hurry. Buckets in a blur, B. Dog, what are you talking about, yo? You got to be so tough to be attentive to him all the time for the whole shot clock. One-on-one kill off the screen. Hey, my God, yo. He said, lay me. I don't only need a tray, B. Dog, that's beautiful. The view is full of buckets, boy. Dog, yo. Man, it's tough, man. It's tough. Like, bro, Pritchard going to the cup. Look at this. Turnover again. Now we out here. Transition killer. Kill a good pass. One more. What are we doing? Everything in transition. All not fully set. Now you have cross matchups. What are we doing? And even though now you're in the half court, but like you could just see they're just demoralized. The Celtics. Look right here. Great cut. Hey, look at this. Non-switchability, dog. Just so what Elite looks like from the Warriors, man. Draymond playing out of his mind, yo. Another 12-2 run. Hey, way to fucking run. Like on the backdoor cut, way to run, yo. Like, dog, look, it's just a different, yo, when You're not attentive, and then now transition, you're getting killed. Now just dog is an uphill battle, and they're just demoralized. Look right here. You can see Rob Bull has to bump Steph on the cut. Now Clay's coming off the screen. Beautiful handoff by Gary Payton and Rob Bull in the drop. Why? Because they have to pay attention to Curry. My goodness, yo. Clay said it's game six. I'm here today. I don't play, boy, even though I play. What are we doing here? And then look at this, bruh, kill. And then Draymond wide open. Perfect thing. You're supposed to leave. Draymond said, I'm going to stay long in the lead because I have the intangibles, boy. Dog, what are we talking about, man? This is just, it's an onslaught. Blow by, you know why? He just missed a short rebound. Offensive rebound again. Relocate. Look at this. Now two got to jump. My goodness, wide open. Look at Jaylen Brown. Didn't even help. He's wide open, bro. Boom. He can actually step back, pump fake, hesitate again, and then shoot. No man. It's Curry, yo. Rebound, you know, these sound good. Strip by Draymond. Pushing the tempo. You already know. Dog, transition, kill, stop, dribble, don't matter. Every man's moving, relocating. He's in the drop. What are we doing? Pass again. Another one in the drop. Look at no one in the drop. Look at, bro. That's... Look at Rob Will in the drop, yo. That's why you push in transition. They know you push in transition. Rob Will's instincts is to protect the paint. And when he has to protect the paint, look at Curry running around freely in these actions with no help. And Marcus Smart has to double jump, spam Y. That's what he's doing, yo. And look at this. No need to rotate. No need to rotate, dog. No need to rotate. There was no screen right there. Marcus Smart was on him, and you just, dog, you just left. Rob Will was playing atrocious. Dog, what is that? Marcus Smart now just chucking. Playing atrocious half-court defense, but great rim protection. But he's not playing great. Look at this. From Egypt. Boom. You know the secret. It gets out of hand when these threes get hoisted, boy. He said, I'm the poster boy. My goodness, yo, that's crazy. He said, stop being lazy. I'm going to pull from here. Give me that tray, B. He said, put a ring on it. Look at this. Watch this. Look at this. Off the screen. And then off the screen again. Dog, Draymond Elite. Elite relocating off the screen, reversing the screen. He said, put a ring on it. Give me that ring, boy. He gave me that fucking ring, yo. That's what he said, yo. And he's here, and no pun intended. Actually, pun intended. He gets the ring and the finals MVP. 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 Four finals ring and his first finals MVP, similar to Kobe. Obviously, different context, but it looks like it's a transition. It could be a transition for him to step into the elite ranks. For real, for real. And you can see their amp, MVP, get credit where credit is due. Obviously, I was wrong about my prediction, but I don't matter when you see buckets on a platter. I could be wrong, and I stand on it because at the end of the day, it's what elite looks like. It's about the game first and everything else second. And he's an MVP, and you just got to, yo, give credit where credit is due. His best finals performance that he's ever had. Elite. It's what elite looks like, and that's game, boy. No, not 10. Bruh, listen. Like I was explaining before, you've seen the footage. Like, for the most part, in the half court, and the Warriors knew that. That's why they were probably confident when they would go down. Something clicked, especially in game four when Steph Curry was getting all those looks. Game five, he was padded, right? And in the half court, Wiggins did a lot of one-on-one and stuff like that. And first of all, before I continue, tip your hat off to Wiggins. Like, the defense he played on Tatum was stellar. Outstanding. Not just on Tatum. He played great defense even on Jaylen when he would be there in situations when he would switch. He would trap certain times. Instead of allowing the switch to happen, he would actually hard hedge the screen and trap Tatum on the screen action and tip the passes. Draymond, same ways. Like, Draymond played out of his mind. Great defense as well. Just the verticality, stunting this guy, helping this guy get him back. Like, that's why I be saying, I tell people, Draymond is like, he's a top five defender of all time. In this era, he's definitely... the most versatile. I think he's the most versatile defender we've ever seen. And I've been said that before because what he has to guard in this era, other guys in that older era just had to guard post-up play. Maybe Draymond might struggle with those type of post-up plays, but I think Draymond would have active hands who reach in scenarios. Like, his IQ is so high that, like, being able to be a hybrid defender, guarding the paint, right? Having verticality in the paint, not necessarily getting the block, even though sometimes he'll get it, but having, making it tough, stripping the ball, being in the passing lanes, roaming as a free safety at times, then other times switching, hard hedging on screens on elite perimeter play in this era in terms of the wings who can ball handle and shoot from deep, right? the KDs, you have the Dames, you have Steph's on his team, but you have Dames, you have a lot of these guys, Kyries, you have a lot of these hoopers that like have skill. Honestly, every guard, De'Aaron Fox, it don't matter who, like a lot of these guys could shoot from deep, could cook and escape, sidestep, like twinkle toe step backs, James Harden, however it is, he could switch on them, guard them one-on-one, hard hedge, recover back to the rope, pad the paint, like he has stellar, he's like literally what KG was, but KG, I didn't see KG have to guard severe talent on the perimeter like that. He will hard hedge, but he's hard hedging on guys when they weren't shooting the three like that, so he could get away with stunting, and even though he would cover, you know what I mean, and move his foot speed and have all of that, he didn't have to extend it as far that Draymond has to at like half court and stuff like that. So that's why I give the knock or the edge to Draymond in terms of just being a more versatile defender. Like back then, it was just you're just a paint protector. A lot of these paint protectors, like Rob Will, are making mistakes. They're the reason why. Like, credit to Rob Will. He's having five blocks. Yada, yada, yeah. When he contests, it's elite. We get it. Great, great contesting defense. But when he's not contesting, what's happening? You see him in the drop plethora of times. That's the same thing that Rudy Gobert be. That's the same thing that Embiid be. I tell people a lot of the time, stop giving credit to these rim protectors like that. It's not the old age anymore. The perimeter defenders, the hybrid, the 80, the KDs, the BAMs, the Draymonds. Those hybrid defenders, Mikal Bridges, perimeter, even Marcus Smart, like these perimeter defenders or hybrid power forward center slash defenders that are elite, give credit to them. They should win Defensive Player of the Year every time. Stop giving it to the Giannis. The Giannis is not, he plays drop. Like he plays like a big man. He plays like Rudy Gobert. He's not covering like the way AD, Bam, and Dre is covering. Draymond is covering. Like that's why I've been trying to tell, man. It's like you saw him put a clinic defensively, a masterclass in game 6. I've been told you, his palms aren't sweaty. Obviously, he looks anus at times and his offense isn't there, whatever. Like, dog, you're going to sack. But when it's time, those intangibles, like, he's made his name not off of scoring. So him not scoring, I'm like, it doesn't matter. Like, if you really have hoop eyes, Draymond scoring never matters. It's a plus. Yeah, he had 12 points. Was 12 points really the difference maker? Now, it was. He had momentum buckets, right? Times where you could see the run coming. Dagger 3. Extend now. You know what I mean? Like, he will hit those ones. But that's not what I care about. The assisting, this is why I say Ben Simmons is going to be this in the Nets, even at a times 2. The assisting, the defense, and just orchestrating everything, pushing in transition. Now that's what they know. They know, Draymond, do what you do. Push in transition. Even if you don't get a bucket, it doesn't matter. You're not supposed to score. When you push in transition, everyone's in help. Look, what's going on? And you stop. Now you do handoffs where mans are literally not paying attention because the person who's supposed to help Marcus Smart is not supposed to be Marcus Smart. When he sets the screen in transition, the guy who's guarding Draymond has to help Steph, has to help Marcus Smart. And that's where you, in transition, that's going to kill you. That relocating those screen, those actions in transition are dangerous. Dangerous. And I try to tell people that, like, that's why Draymond is so vital. As much as, yes, Steph Curry is the one and he's him, Draymond has unlocked Steph to a whole new echelon because Draymond is playmaking. Steph could just roam and be like, be Rip Hamilton, Ray Allen 2.0. He can afford that luxury because Draymond is ball handling. Draymond is having IQ, pushing transition. If not Steph, okay, I look to my left. Now Clay's moving. Like, the secondary help is never there when I push in transition. And that's how they killed them. This game came down to a lot of, like, I would say if I had to put a percentage of it, like, when it mattered, when they went on that run, it was like 75% of their buckets was transition. In half court, they still weren't scoring OD like that. It was transition. Transition. Whenever they got an opportunity off a miss, turnovers, you already know Boston Celtics, bad turnovers, credit to the Warriors defense, bad turnovers. Transition like this. And every man was downhill. Wiggins dunk. Like, I showed it all. And then when you're in an uphill battle versus a team like this, like, you better go, you better make all your threes, like what they did in game 1 for them to overcome that. They didn't do that. Like, now you get tighter. Now Jason Tatum's palms looking more sweatier because Wiggins is fighting through all the screens, not allowing mismatches. Then when Curry's there, he's containing properly, then getting active hands. Like, you know what I mean? Like, Curry wasn't even a mismatch like that, even though they would attack him in other times. This time now the confidence just rises. When you're offensively at ease, your defense just picks up. That's why I say people make teammates better. You don't have to pass to make your teammates better. Just the intangibles you do goes a long way. momentum shifting, snapping, like all those, the ease you give to other teammates goes a long way because now their confidence rises. Everybody's more confident when there's the pressure is at ease. And that's what I try to tell people. Like, only if you hoop, you kind of know these things because it's not spoke. It's not things that are spoken about. It's not things that you even speak about with your teammates. It's just you know when you're in it. You know what I'm saying? You know when you're in it. So, again, obviously I'm wrong in my prediction, but I'm still right in my assessment. You give the drop on Steph Curry, he's going to kill you. He's going to kill you. You're going to let the Warriors play in transition, they're going to kill you. If you don't switch everything versus this team consistently, you can't do it here and there. If you do it in spots, they can still fry you because they're comfortable in the drop. Like, if you do it out the gate, switch everything, right? You hedge, you trap sometimes, but switch everything for the most part. Obviously, you're going to have miscommunication here and there, but if you switch everything, you're going to force them to one-on-one. The Warriors don't want to live in a one-on-one ISO every day, all day. They don't want to do that. Even if Steph Curry's killing, he has 30 or 40 in one-on-ones. Klay is not in rhythm. Other guys aren't in rhythm. So now, for the most part, like, it's not what they want, because there'll be times even KD would have 40 sometimes, and they'll be struggling to win. Like, you'll be close in the game. When they blow you out, when they kill you is transitional play, and all these actions off open looks. Now everybody's in a whole new comfortability zone that now their defense is better. Everything just rises as time goes. That's why you don't see Warriors, for the most part, give up leads. They don't really do that. That's why people were surprised in game one when the Celtics gave up a lead like that, or when the Celtics came back and the Warriors gave up a lead in the fourth quarter. That doesn't really happen, because this team, when they increase their lead, they get stronger as with more power. They're like the Hulk. The more angry they get, the more comfortable they get, they just build. The more you hit them, what is it, Wolverine? Like, dog, the more they keep going, they just keep going. And then they kill you, then Steph's at the fourth quarter. Like, that's what they be doing. That's how they play. That's how they move. So, like, you rarely see them have a 20-point lead and then man's come back. That's why I kind of was like, that third quarter, second quarter, end of first, second quarter run, 21-0, like, that's why I didn't even need to show the rest. That's when the damage was done. And then when the third quarter, when they were kind of pushing, Al Horford's making threes, Jaylen Brown's trying to snap in the fourth, like, Tatum was obviously MIA, but those guys were trying to snap. Transit, they kept pushing the tempo. They didn't change. That's great culture from Steve Kerr. That's great IQ from Draymond, obviously reading it and just pushing. And then even Steph pushing in transition. They all were on a string. So tip your hat off. Give credit where credit is due. Again, I was wrong in my prediction. I have no problem ever admitting when I'm wrong, obviously. You know, the footage tells you that I was wrong, but the footage tells you that I wasn't wrong at the same time, because my analysis of what if I expected something that didn't happen. If someone was going to tell me, yo, the Celtics are going to play a drop all series, I would have told you shit done in five, yo. Like, they played a drop for four straight games where Curry was averaging like 36, 35, I checked, on 50% shooting. It went down after game five, but he's already comfortable now. Like, you can't let a guy like Steph roam comfortably for four straight games and think that now he's just going to, like, if they adjusted their defense completely and stayed and committed to it, maybe he might struggle. You know, he struggled game five, maybe game six. Like, that happened in 2016. But for the most part, the Cavs did the same principle defense. Like, I'm just shocked that the Celtics played this kind of defense. I don't understand. Like, Udoka has a high IQ. I know maybe they're fearful of Steph ISOing, but if you watch back other finals, obviously Steph's a different demon. Mentally, he's more comfortable. He has three rings before that. He's more so seasoned in his prime, right? Like, his prime is extended. He's more so comfortable. He's grown over the years, right? Like, it's like when Kobe was in the three-peat, now he's has Gasol. He's more so, he's the main guy. Obviously, it's different context where Steph been the main guy and didn't get finals MVP. That's why I don't equate it the same, but I equate it the same in the retrospect of the fourth ring is your first finals MVP. Like, he's more so like getting over the hump individually, right? Confident wise, like not being palm sweaty wise, all of that. Like, you could just smell it. It felt like destiny. But the Celtics gave, like, they kind of contributed to that destiny heavily. Like, they didn't force him to like have to be in an unconventional situation where now he's like, he really had to like dig deep. Steph didn't have to dig deep. He didn't have to dig deep. The ankle injury, he did. But I'm talking about the looks he was getting. Like, he still made tough looks because men are, like, contesting, like, from the back and hitting his leg. Like, it's still tough. Like, don't get it twisted. But, like, the creation of the tough is not, like, the origin of, like, starting it out, like, one-on-one and then getting the tough. Like, that wasn't what he was operating in the whole series. Like, the Celtics defense they played on KD and the Celtics defense they played on Steph was two different defenses. Like, there was no sense of urgency. They're like, they literally, like, I was just confused. Like, I didn't expect that. And I think maybe, and that's a testament to how different KD is. I could see them being like, they didn't have urgency on Giannis like that. That's why they let him get off some games. They're like, we could just contain him in whatever, right? Same thing with Jimmy Butler. That's why he was able to go off as well, too. They didn't have the same urgency. One-on-one, we're not going, you know what I mean? We're not going to lose with that. And I think they kind of thought, if we contain him, yes, his tempo, he'll shoot whatever. But, like, for the most part, if we contain him majority of the times, like, the actions and whatever, and, you know, just attack him on the offensive end, he'll be tired and he'll probably miss his shots. Like, that's kind of what they're thinking was. And I'm like, I was just flabbergasted at that kind of line of thinking. And, like, that line of thinking, like, I didn't understand it. Like, Steph is him. Like, why would you ever give this kind of demon these type of shots? Like, this man is putting the ring on, like, mid-game, yo. Dog, like, that's crazy. So, again, Steph is elite. Some guys, even when you give them an advantage, their palms get sweaty on this stage that they might not shoot, like, they won't shoot the lights up. I did not have any worry of Steph killing if you give him those looks. Never. I just thought they weren't going to give him those looks. And then now I was talking about Steph in that light. So, again, I was wrong. You know, it is what it is. Again, hats off. You know, give credit where credit is due. Wiggins, again, changed the whole narrative, you know, because, you know, he had lackadaisical play. He had, when in Minnesota, he kind of was lackadaisical. He still was averaging 20. His ability was never questioned to the elites, like, to the Hoopers. You know, like, for you to be young and average 20-plus, like, you're already elite. Like, you're in a ranking that most people don't get. Granted, obviously, it's only him in Towns, and he gets a lot of your usage. But for the most part, again, you still have to have the ability to even capitalize on that, right? And he had the ability. So I was never questioning his ability, but sometimes his intangibles wasn't really there because clearly he wasn't motivated. When you have a losing team around you, like, sometimes it's like, what am I really doing? Some guys are like the Kobe's where they'll force, you know what I mean? They're going to force it. They're going to be mad. They're going to cuss guys. You know what I mean? Wiggins is not that. And that's where you can kind of see people's characters are different. So that kind of character, given a different situation, he's going to rise to the occasion. That's why when the trade happened, you can go back and try and quote me, find it. I said, yo, Wiggins is basically HB 2.0. He's in between KD and HB. HB is here. Harrison Barnes. KD is here. And Andrew Wiggins is in between. If they won with Harrison Barnes, obviously granted injuries to the Cavs, they won with KD, why wouldn't they win with Wiggins if Klay comes back healthy, which I thought he would? Remember, non-dominant leg Achilles. Why would he not be healthy? And his game wasn't predicated on athleticism. It was on shooting. So I never questioned Klay coming back. And he's still, this is his first time coming back. He's only going to get better, right? Obviously, the shooting, whatever. And he had great looks. It wasn't like, and he was still aggressive. So, like, mentality wasn't a question. It was just rhythm, not being there the whole year. Now you increase the defense and all that type of stuff. Like, he's not fully there yet, even though he's getting there. People writing him off still. Like, I didn't write him off. He's missing open looks. So I knew, like, when you have a Klay, just him, his presence even, period, at a normal, healthy version, you have Steph, you have Draymond, that trio's still there. You add Wiggins to that, who is literally an upgrade from HB, a downgrade from KD, they could win with that. But I thought that's why I never questioned them getting to the finals. Again, them and the Suns, I had the Suns winning, but the Suns never got there. Obviously, they're going to beat the Mavs, you already know. But again, it was context. For me, I never doubted the Warriors. I knew that they were going to be elite. I didn't know how quick Klay could turn around, but I knew them not being elite was never my question. It was now without KD, when they get to those, you know, conference finals, when man switch everything, which I'm expecting, the one-on-one play, can Wiggins do it at a steady diet? And he didn't have to because man's didn't play. The switch, they didn't switch everything. You know, they played the drop. So, you know, Wiggins put in work. You tip your hat off. Again, elite play. No fear. Just beautiful to see. Gary Payton Jr., you know what I mean? Gary Payton II, getting his ring as well, too. Going, like, you have a lot of guys who the narratives just changed drastically off this ring, and you just love to see it. You know, Klay going through what he went through, Steph going through what he went through, and then all the narratives, the non-finals MVP getting his, Draymond also too going what he went through, the people bashing him and saying this and that, he's not a Leon, whatever, which I never doubted because I know his intangibles been strong. You know what I mean? So he coming back. There's a lot of guys, Steve Kerr, like there's a lot of narratives that panned out beautifully with this ring in terms of Jordan Poole is still there now. They have a young core. Like they're literally like what the Suns was doing, but at a better version because they've been winning, right? So like having older guys with a perfect mesh of younger guys, right? So it's like, is what it looks like, man. Obviously, again, like I said, give credit where credit is due. Again, this was a legacy finals for Steph. And that's why I was kind of like, okay, we're really going to see what he's made of if Mans force him to be in that one-on-one play. But they didn't do it. So he's going to be elite, and he still capitalized. Like, he smelled blood. He smelled blood, and he took advantage of it. That's why they kind of didn't really have any worry. To win three straight games, that's crazy. Like, it's similar to what they did. It's literally similar to when they faced the Cavs. 2-1 down, three straight. Went on the road. Like, that's literally what they did in 2015. And they did it again, you know, how many years later? 7 years later, 2022. So, again, tip your hats off. You know what I mean? It's what Elite looks like, again, like I was saying. And then also, you know, I'm going to also do a video because, my whole point, you already know, I debunk cap narratives. That's my passion for the game and authenticity for the game. I'm going to see cap, and I'm going to have to, like, try to educate against the cap as much as I can based off the footage and the film. So I've waited till the whole finals is done. Next week, you're definitely going to see an explanation of this whole KD stuff. They're going to see a lot of breakdown film. I'm going to do that because people are bringing up this narrative that the Celtics played the same defense versus KD and then with Steph. And then now, look, you know, people are going to kill KD, obviously. And again, oh, my God, you're a KD fan. It's not a, like, dog, if you know me, even if people say I'm a LeBron hater, there's times where I'm like, I give LeBron credit where I'm like, yo, that's cap. Like, this guy's not on his level. Like, you know what I mean? Like, if you really understand, it's about rating everything accordingly. I'm going to see him as a hater because I don't give praise in certain scenarios where everyone's giving praise. I debunk the praise because y'all are overboosting it. Y'all, you know what I mean? Y'all are reading it wrong. So I kind of, you know, here's some IQ here. Here's some IQ here. This man is sussing. I call it out. Kawhi, you sussing? Why you, like, dog, come, we don't rate that right here. You rate here, we rate that right here. You know what I'm saying? Like, you got to, it's unbiased. Everybody that I've gave credit to, at some point in time, I've obviously said something negative about them. Like, it's just being unbiased. That's what it's about. So I just stand on that for the most part and just try to, you know, read the footage and then just use IQ and kind of do an analysis based on the footage, breakdown based on the footage, and everything else is second besides that. So, again, we're going to do a breakdown on all of that. I know y'all been waiting. The time is now. It's perfect how both KD and Steph face the Celtics so we can kind of dissect both and kind of see where the IQ is, where, what's right, what's wrong, what's going on here, what happened, what transpired. So stay tuned for that. Again, we're still going to talk about, you know, trades. We got draft. We got a lot of things. You know, it never ends. It's a 24/7 cycle. So again, it's true talks. It's true talks. Share, like, and subscribe. We out here. There's no doubt here. There's no drought here. You feel me? I appreciate y'all. You already know. It's what Elite looks like, man. You already know.